Master J, Run DMC. When Jam Master J's came on stage, the place lit up. He's like, you seen the Run DMC show, you'll never forget it. And he was that life and that energy.
On the night before Halloween, October 30th, 2002.
A newsflash came on the TV and it says a rapper, known rapper in Queens, gunned down in studio.
Jason Mizell, the turntable wizard known as Jam Master J, was silenced at his 24/7 recording studio on Merrick Boulevard. He was 37.
Some guy came right in, dark clothing. There was a brief conversation, two gunshots.
Detective Vincent Santangelo of the 103 squad has been on the case from the start.
He was just lying on the floor against the back wall.
Mizell had provided the backbeat for the platinum-selling Run DMC. But neither of the two lead singers were in the house that night.
It's definitely not a crazed fan.
Rap Royalty initially offered a $60,000 reward.
A lot of people are silent in the community.
Mizell's assistant, Lydia High, was sitting on a couch diagonally across from him, and his friend, Tony Rincone, was next to him. Mizell's business partner and two other men were mixing music in a closed recording room.
Were there surveillance cameras at this scene?
Yes.
Did they work?
None of them work.
Jason Mizell had a TV monitor that was right next to the video game he was playing on the night he was killed. It was supposed to show surveillance images of anyone entering the studio. But when investigators responded to the scene, they found that the tape inside, a VHS tape, was either old or it had been replaced. It was pretty much useless. This is the hallway where Mizell's body was taken out the back way that night.
God knows who did it. Some other people know who did it, but they're not speaking up because they're involved too.
The DJ's mother spoke to us by phone from her North Carolina home. His brother met us by a tribute painted for Mizell in the Hollis neighborhood where they grew up.
Do you feel the people inside the studio really knew the identities of the killers?
Yes, I do.
But the two eyewitnesses never talked much to the family.
My conversation with Tony was limited because he had security at the gravesite.
He brought security team to the gravesite?
Yeah, him, Lydia High, they all had security at the gravesite. Her and her brother and everybody moved out of town.
The female witness did identify one person involved.
Yes, she did.
The lookout.
Yes.
A federal prisoner now doing time for armed robbery was the suspected lookout, but he's never been charged. And an aspiring Hollywood producer from Queens, Curtis Schoon, got tired of being blamed for ordering the hit over an old drug debt.
A 13-year-old beef, and if the money was the problem, I'm quite sure my brother made that money 10 times over that he could have gave Mr. Schoon that little small piece of change.
So you don't think Curtis Schoon was behind it?
I don't think Curtis Schoon might have been behind it.
I reached out to Schoon on Twitter and received this message. Hi, Mary, I think I know what you want to talk about and I'm not interested. I have nothing to offer. I simply deserve an apology. Then Schoon followed up with another tweet. Just know it's in no one's interest to solve anything because of all the liability they will incur for rushing to judgment.
What went wrong? Because he was a good guy. I mean, he would look out for the people in the neighborhood, you know.
Robert Craig and many in Hollis remember Mizell's generosity to this day.
I always told him to watch his pockets because there's too many hands in his pockets.
Cops have the 40 caliber bullets from the scene.
11 years and there's been no match.
So you never found the gun that was used?
Never found the gun.
One of these days it will be solved. And someone will tap them on their shoulder and call their name and say, got you.